Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Give us the energy and the strength that we need to make decisions tonight to bless this county. These things we pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Bill. This time will come to order. Again, welcome to this, the only meeting in July 2012, Alamance County Board of Commissioners. Commissioners will start by reviewing the agenda, including the consent agenda. Would like to note any items that any commissioner would like pulled from consent, review the rest of the agenda, and then we will make a motion for approval. Is there any item on consent that any commissioner would wish to be pulled?
Item G.
Item G, local emergency declaration ordinance. Pull that from consent, and let's be careful where we put that. You don't care where we put that, do you?
I don't care.
Mr. Honeycutt, let's put that after item 10, if that's all right.
Okay.
Any other items off consent? Hearing none, entertain a motion for approval of the agenda, including the change in what is on the consent agenda. Is there such a motion?
Make a motion.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
I'll second. Okay.
Thank you, Linda and Bill. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good. We have no public comments tonight, so I'm assuming since there are no comments, there are no responses, but are there any commissioner responses at this time?
No.
If not, we'll move on to item 6, ACC bond referendum discussion and resolution. Mr. Craig Honeycutt, County Manager. Welcome back, Craig.
Thank you. Good to be back. In front of you tonight is a request from the Alamance Community College for a $15 million bond referendum to pay for their new career and tech building. This has been discussed by the board over a year now, and so the request needs to be approved one way or another tonight so we can make sure that this is on the ballot for November. But one thing we did add, if you'll also see, we've added the amortization schedule in here for a 20-year bond at $15 million. But one thing we did also add in here, there's been a lot of discussion amongst the board about the possibility of using a sales tax, the additional quarter cent sales tax, to pay for that debt service for the community college, and that resolution is here as well.
How would you like to proceed, Mr. Honeycutt?
I believe there's some representative from ACC here as well who may have some comments. That may be a good place to start.
Would you like to come to the podium?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Steinbecker, Chair of the Alamance County Community College Board of Trustees. Welcome.
Thank you, Commissioners and County Manager. I guess the only comments that we wanted to share with you this evening is that, again, we feel very, very strongly about the need for this facility. Obviously, we've been working on it for the last 2 years. And I guess the thing that we feel very strong about is that we would like to hope that there would be general, on the referendum, we would hope that there would be something that would be just asking the general community about their support for the community college bond. And how that bond might be retired via either property tax or sales tax certainly is obviously your decision, but we think that it's pretty important to give the community an opportunity to have just a separate voting item that would state something about, are you in favor of supporting a bond for the building of a new facility at Alamance Community College, and allow the community to weigh in on whether or not that is something that they feel that we need at this time. Then, if how that's funded, if it's via sales tax or through property tax, that's certainly, at obviously your discretion, but we would like and request you to consider that if that's possible. We feel very strongly that we'd like to have an opportunity for the citizens to be able to vote just on the concept of whether or not they are in support of it. And then if they are in support of it, then it's up to, obviously, the commissioners to figure out how we go about paying for it. Dr. Nadelman, is there anything else that...
What eloquent.
So that's kind of our message for this evening, and we'll leave it with you at this point.
Well, thank you. Before you leave,
yes,
while you're at the mic, the commissioners have any questions for Chairman Steinbecker? Well, we appreciate you being here, and it's good to have you and Dr. Nadelman with us. You are free and welcome to come back at any time.
Okay, well, we really do appreciate all your support. We know how difficult this is and the challenges ahead, but we do appreciate you doing what you can to help us move this forward. Thank you.
Well, we can't operate the way he wants us to do it, can we?
Yes.
So we have to say whatever the tax is going to be, where it's going to...
No, we actually can't.
I think what he's asking is to have some mechanism so the citizens can vote first on the concept of building this school, and then after that have a bond referendum, if I'm understanding what he said.
Well, what they're asking for is for the county to basically issue debt for $15 million. And not say how we pay for it, do a separate, if this is approved, then go back and do a separate sales tax referendum and maybe use that for the debt service. But if that didn't pass, we would then have to raise taxes probably a penny and a half to cover the $15 million debt service.
I'm not going to support that.
What, Craig, can you maybe back up a little bit and chop this thing up for us in terms of the steps and the options at each step of the way?
Well, with respect to the sales tax, you cannot specify in the ordinance or on the ballot what that money is to be used for. You can only say that do you support an additional quarter cent sales tax above and beyond our current sales tax, yes or no. The board could, by resolutions, state your intention, which would be separate. Say, our intention is to use the additional quarter cent for debt repayment for ACC. That's one option. If the board then said, well, we want to put this on the referendum, the $15 million request, in discussions I've had with Dr. Nadelman, they do not need the funding for about a year. So if the bond or if the referendum did pass, then that would give us time to do another sales tax referendum if that's the way we want to pay for it. The downside of that is if that sales tax didn't pass, we're still stuck with the $15 million worth of new debt. And we would have to come up with some mechanism to pay for that debt service. And that would be a tax increase. Hopefully I clarified.
Well, and I'm hearing everybody say that if we go with the option of the sales tax increase, we cannot specify on the ballot by state law what it's earmarked for.
Yes, sir.
Even though we could state separately.
We can do a resolution.
But it would not appear on the ballot.
Okay. It would not appear on the ballot.
But you after your referendum, let's say the board approved to move forward with the sales tax, and the voters approved it, a majority of the voters approved it, then you're required to give 10 days notice and have a public hearing. after they approve. And then, at that point in time, then you can say how you're going to use that tax. When you have your resolution approving it and you begin the levy, because you have to have that resolution along with the statement from the Board of Elections. You have to send that to Raleigh so the Department of Revenue can start collecting the tax.
When would that tax start?
That would, let's just say it's on the, let's say the referendum's on the ballot for November 6th.
Right.
And it's passed. And then right after it passes, you can call a public hearing, 10 days notice, and have your public hearing and get your certification from the election board and your resolution approving the tax to the Department of Revenue. And I guess the earliest would be, what, April 1st? Mm-hmm. Which one they would start collecting. It's going to take a quarter.
So 90 days after that?
Yes.
Okay. What is the estimated annual debt service on the $15 million?
$1.3 million.
$1.3 million. What is the estimated amount of revenue on a quarter cent sales tax?
What is that?
Because we don't have share.
$3.8 million. Because again, all that revenue does come to the county and is not shared with the municipalities.
So other uses for that revenue beyond what's necessary to service the debt could be what?
I'm sorry.
Other uses for the revenue beyond servicing this debt would be what?
Whatever the board so chose. And you could state that in the resolution how you would like to spend that additional revenue.
Well, it's nice we're going to have some training here coming in, but what are we going to do about jobs? I mean, I don't know if that's an option or not. Is there anything we could do to stimulate some economic growth in the county?
You could allocate that additional funding to economic development. One thing that we lack is funding for infrastructure and funding to purchase land, and that's becoming a big deal for some companies, is land and infrastructure.
Well, yeah, the folks at the chamber would put, I think, ready land and infrastructure at the top of their list in terms of what companies are looking for, even right. Beyond trained labor force and even beyond direct incentives, I think.
We have really one site-ready park, which is NCIC in Mebane. We got a lot of great raw land in the county, but not, you know, a lot of developable, shovel-ready property for industrial.
Which is what companies look for when they're looking to relocate. I mean, I've seen a lot of stuff going on in Davidson County. I don't know what they got going on. Maybe somebody, Tim, have you talked to them any about that?
Not about that.
Yeah.
Well, how would that work, Craig? Can you expand on that a little bit in terms, you mentioned the word infrastructure.
Well, you would probably have to set up a separate board, work with the municipalities and probably the chamber, and have an advisory board that would meet. Requests would come to that advisory board, and then final approval for expenditures would be by the Board of Commissioners.
So whatever we do, as far as drawing down funds, would have to be approved separately by this board?
Yes, sir.
And that, who would take requests to a board like that? Would it be municipality, or would it be the company directly, or would it be the chamber?
It could probably come from multiple sources. You know, there'd probably have to be criteria set up and framework about what's fundable and what's not fundable. That would probably be a big issue and kind of separating the wheat from the chaff on that.
Well, if we allocated a chunk of money for that, is there a drawdown period, or is it just?
It would be part of our monthly receipts from sales tax.
that would be earmarked for what?
That quarter cent, if the board so chose, would be earmarked for economic development or however else you wish to fund it. You know, again, the first chunk of it would be for the ACC debt service. And then the second would be for whatever the board so chose. And if it's economic development, it would be economic development.
Just back to the sales tax revenue in general, do we have to specify all the specific uses that this additional money would equal? Or could we say, okay, well, here's the ACC plot, here's an economic infrastructure piece, and what?
It'd kind of be a running total for your ED funds, you know, just whatever was available. You would have to do a separate accounting for it.
Oh, right, I understand that. I'm talking about beyond those two, based on what you just said, we'd have more funds available than just to satisfy the needs of
this bond for the school.
Well, just for example, Orange County did approve the quarter cent sales tax, and they put X percent to economic development, X percent to infrastructure, X percent to EMS, transportation. So the board could, you know, be unlimited on how you wanted to do that.
Well, I guess my question is that X percent wouldn't have to add up to 100 then, because whatever was left would just come into the general revenue stream,
right,
which would offset or could offset property tax increases in the future.
It could possibly do that as well.
Mm. Well, we've all had individual discussions, as quoted in the media, about thoughts on sales tax revenue versus property tax revenue. Does anybody want to talk about that for a minute? Because it'd be good for us to hear it all together, the pros and cons.
Well, I mean, I understand what they're asking. They're wanting to have a separate issue, but I'm not against the sales tax. I wasn't the first time, and I think if we do designate it where it might go, I think that would be a much better thing, and I think the people of this county might get behind it, because what you're looking at, you also have sales tax from outside of this county coming in paying sales tax. Instead of putting the whole burden on the property tax on, you know, property owners, it helps take a little bit off of them.
Yeah, I agree with that philosophy. I think that the property owners pay enough taxes, and the sales tax is something that a lot of people that don't own property is going to have to pay sales tax. So I'm in favor of a sales tax. If there's a tax, that's the only fair tax.
Yeah, you're right.
And I agree with that, too. Yeah, I don't have a problem with the sales tax, you know, as long as we can put it to economic development or even whatever's left can go into the general fund, you know.
Well, there's no point in having two different votes on this,
no,
in my opinion. And that's what you would have if you do the referendum on one and then turn around and want to look at the sales tax later. Referendum, that'd be two different votes, and I don't think that's efficient government. You know, Randolph County, they had a local option sales tax on the ballot down there, and it was to be designated for the community college. I don't know how they had it worded. Do you know by chance how they had it worded?
I haven't seen that resolution.
But that was a good while ago, and it shocked me, really, that it passed. But
Do you remember how the margin?
The margin, no. But it surprised me that it passed. And it's my understanding that how they passed it was put on during a general election and defeated. And then I was told later they came back in and put it on as a single stand issue in an off-year scenario. Then you get a lot of supporters coming out just for that. But the thing that I've always had an issue with, not negative, but I think it's worth talking about, is what percentage of students come in from out of the county that attend our college. And I know we have some that go out to other counties, but we have definitely a lot coming in. I understand it's 20-some percent or better. Is that correct, Dr. Nadelman? Is that figure about right?
It is, and it's also one of the lowest figures in the state.
Right.
Durham Tech, 58% of their students are from their service area.
48,
42% are not.
Right.
And a lot of it has to do, isn't it, with specific programs that the community college may offer that other community colleges don't? I mean, if you specialize in the...
Every community college doesn't offer all the programs.
Right.
That's the draw. That's their intent, to make sure that we're not offering 58 heating and air conditioning programs or 58 equine programs or whatever it would be.
But I do believe people coming in from out of the county would pay sales tax coming here for their purchases and so forth, which I think is more equitable than charging property owners in this county solely the cost of building the college for 27% to come from another county. I do believe that, irregardless of what Durham does. That's a heavy burden, I think, on our community college system.
So could we not put it on the same ballot as the bond referendum at the same time, or we got to do it as separate?
We would have to.
We're not talking about the same thing now.
You can. What the bond referendum basically does, it authorizes you to issue debt by the voters.
Okay.
It doesn't say how to pay for it, but the general feeling would be, and the strong recommendation would be, we can't absorb any additional debt service.
Right. No, we can't.
So you're talking first year, $1,387,000. That's $15 million over a 20-year period. You know, that would amortize. It would come down annually, but you would have to put at least a penny and a quarter probably your first year.
That's property tax.
But you can also do the sales tax also on the same ballot. You can have them both.
That's what I'm saying.
The issue that I think it would confuse voters.
I think it would confuse voters.
I personally, my recommendation, you'd have the referendum. Well, referendums usually mean property tax increase. Then you got to increase for sales tax. Well, that's a tax increase also. Not understanding that the sales tax would pay off the debt. I think it...
Can you not say that on the ballot?
No, ma'am. Mm-hmm. No, ma'am.
It's directed as what Clyde's draft is.
But we could adopt a resolution stating
we can educate the public as much as possible.
Right.
Specifically, and as Clyde's exactly right, you do have to state after it's passed exactly what you're going to do, but we can also state our intentions beforehand.
Right.
In a formal resolution,
which becomes part of what our agreement is, even though it's not on the ballot that way.
Well, in the follow-up on Linda's question about twice, if I'm understanding where this could go, if the referendum is approved and the sales tax is defeated, then it defaults to a property tax increase.
Yes, sir. Unless you wanted to try it again.
Well, but the building is underway.
It's about a year, I think, before you need financing.
Next year, 2013, next year, about this time.
Well, going back to the kind of the development piece, if we in this resolution, this side resolution, said, okay, $15 million for community college and $5 million for economic development, is that something that could be
put into
one kind of side intent resolution?
Well, yes, sir. If you remember when the board asked us to look at what are other communities our size doing with respect to economic development, the biggest difference was funding. You know, for very honestly, we were either the second lowest out of 18 counties for funding. So this would start getting us in line on the funding side where other counties our size that we compete with on a daily basis are at.
Well, as I started out saying, we're doing a great job here. If we put this on, we build a nice building, train people, we still need jobs. Our unemployment rates are horrible, and we need to look to how we might encourage some new business coming here.
Well, I think we need to encourage and let the folks outside the county know that we are committed to doing that. The project itself, Tim, you had asked for some information. Did you have any questions about things like square footage and all that?
Well, we can get that answer. What is the square foot cost of that building?
Well, it's 62,000 square feet. You're looking at $15 million. You know, you got architect's fees in there, you got contingency fees. You're looking at a little over $200 a square foot.
How much of it's the building proper?
Probably that amount.
15?
We have to.
No, everything. See, the way the state requires us to submit information, it's got the architect's fees, it's got the contingency in there. So I would say that the square footage is right around $200 a square foot, somewhere in that. It's close to that.
What, I'm just curious, because as you know, I'm down there. What are you going to do for parking for the facility and?
Well, part of that, there's money in there for about 100 extra parking spaces or so. Again, you're not Well, you're not talking about adding a lot of students. You're talking about adding some. You know, you're talking, these are small programs that are going to expand from like 18 to 24 or 16 to 24. So you're going to add a few more people. Now, what it will do is give us a little more classroom space. So just where you are. I mean, we've got room for about 100 spaces down in our gravel area that we can add some more gravel, so that's cheap. And then we've got some property to the south of the college on top that we would be able to clear and put about another 100 parking spaces in. Because when we put the building in where it's designed to go, we're probably going to lose about 50 parking spaces.
Well, that's what I was wondering. Where the building is now is parking, right? I mean, where your planned building site is,
yes.
There's
right.
Some parking.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And it, we would lose about 50 of those spaces, and let's say we could add 150 spaces.
Well, I mean, I think it's exciting that they are considering this. These are some things that definitely are needed things in our county. Talking to some business people, they want people trained and ready to go to work when they come out of the school, and I think some of the things will give you new technology that's not there now.
Exactly. Well, a machining program, for example.
Right.
We want a 4.5 axis machine. We can't put it anywhere. We've got it now.
Right.
And they're up to 5 axis machines, so our 4.5 is close, but it'll get us to where we need to be. Right now, it's impossible to put it in that square footage that we have. Mm-hmm.
Well, I just like to add that I appreciate you guys looking at the alternative sites.
We looked at a lot.
Well, yeah, and I know many were brought to you, and we were asked by a number of folks, what about this, what about that, and I know you explored every one of them, so I appreciate that. And you all are comfortable through your due diligence that the site on campus is the best one.
Yes, sir. For what we need to do for the dollars. The problem is when we looked at buildings that were 20 and 30 years old, to spend 170 plus per square foot to renovate them, it just didn't seem to make dollar or sense, because the building's net life is only another 20 years. So this way we're going to get the new facility for a lot more life.
Which I'm assuming all this will be built to new lead specification and so forth.
Yeah, we were looking at silver lead.
Yeah.
That's one of the things that we built into our how much we're going to save. Mm-hmm. And the problem with the 30-year-old buildings, you know, they're fine. But when you renovate them more than a certain percentage of their cost, you've got to put all brand new code up to
you got to bring it up to a new code.
And we were talking about gutting this whole building. It just, all you're getting is a shell.
Well, I just knew that your space was cramped when your horticulture area was being overtaken by autofins.
Plants don't like that.
Yeah, plants don't like that.
Yeah.
And heating and air was jammed up in a little room.
Well, I'm surprised you haven't hurt somebody.
I agree. If you've never been down there and seen it, you don't know the gist of it, really.
It was cramped.
Well, I mean, I like the idea of maybe adding some additional for something on the economic development side. I don't know how we do that. I mean, I don't.
Craig, how would we do that?
If the board maybe set some parameters, you know, first parameter would be debt service. Second parameter would be economic development. If there was any additional parameters we wanted to see, and then we would try to do a resolution based upon the $3.4 million expenditures and give you some options. We could do that at the next meeting.
So what we could do, for instance, tonight is say, okay, the parameters of $15 million for the building cost, and I mean, I threw out the number 5 minutes ago, $5 million for economic development would be identified as expenditures for the use of
the quarters and sales. Yes, sir.
And then the estimate, whatever is left, we can either earmark later or it can go in the general fund.
Right. You know, again, it could be, we have economic incentive cash payments to use for that. You know, there's a lot of different things that could be used for.
But whatever it's used for, it would come back to us for?
Well, there would have to be a governing structure set up with a framework. If the board did approve going forward and this is the direction, we would then try to get with our municipal partners in the chamber and try to set up some frameworks on what's necessary and proper as far as expenditures from this for economic development. What are their needs? Because again, our municipalities have all the water and sewer. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to be able to work with them on developing property, especially with infrastructure.
How much more a year would that add as far as payment wise?
Well, again, it would just be revenue that we would receive from the sales tax on a monthly basis.
Oh, okay.
So we would set that aside as a separate budget.
To pay for that.
Right. If we budget right now $3.4 million of sales tax, you take $1.3 off the top of that. And then try to budget
and
the additional
the
2 months.
Well, then it'd be another third of that.
Our percentage, we can use. Right.
And how is our sales tax now? I mean, are we?
Our sales tax is going to come in, I think, we're looking pretty good. I mean, we're going to come in right at budget for, say, last fiscal year. So, but you might, on this, you know, you might want to say the first 1.3 goes to the debt service and then use a percentage. Like if you want to say 25% go to economic development, because not knowing exactly how much we're going to get in, and we can set up a separate fund, 25% could just go into that fund, and then if you want to say another 25% goes to whatever,
right.
We just do it by percentage.
Okay. Just wanted to see what.
Well, and I guess specifically, we could say, what'd you say, 1.3 million, Amy?
For the debt service.
So whatever, a third of 1.3 million can be set aside for economic development, right?
Yes.
I mean, I'd almost rather see dollar amounts so the people that are on this new board know what they have to deal with.
Right.
Now, the new board would have, who puts that board together? Do we put it together?
This board
puts it together. So it could be people from the chamber, it could be a municipal representative, it could be people at large.
Again, that's when we looked at the other communities and how they did it. That's basically the way they did it, was, you know, governmental representation, but all chamber representation, business representation, general public. So
all the people that have buy into economics.
We would then come up with some bylaws and put some meat on that bone, yes.
Which we would have to do between the success of the sales tax and April 1st.
Yes.
Right.
To set something like that up. Yeah. Well, I guess we're still on the question, the bond referendum, I guess. We just need to vote on this, right? I mean,
a motion can be made addressing strictly the sales tax option if that's what the board wants to do. Are you in a position to
offer a motion? I will make a motion that we do a sales tax resolution, but do we need to do them separate? I mean,
I think it'll be all.
I'm not sure.
I think.
I mean, as a vote, we really need to separate them.
It's really, you don't have to consider the other one, but I think as part of your motion, if the sales tax is the option for funding that you are so choosing, that you mention that in the motion that
okay.
with
all
know,
right.
the first
there's 15 going here
the first $1.3 million of the sales tax going to pay for debt service for that $15 million ACC bond referendum or bond ACC construction request.
But could we also say that the next whatever a third of
the bond 1.3
be designated for
right,
and
I think so. With a portion for economic development and requests that staff bring you back a specific resolution on percentages and all that at our next meeting.
Well, and again, only to quantify it so we know what we're talking about here. If we're saying ACC's cost is $15 million, I think we ought to earmark X, whether it's $5 million or whatever. With economic development piece because
and that's okay. I'm okay if we need a dollar amount. I mean, we do realize
right.
that we're bringing in three what on sales?
3.4. 3.8 is
yeah.
3.4.
So,
all right, well, state your motion. I'll be
all right. I make a motion that we put on the agenda the ACC bond for $15 million and $5 million towards economic development with a resolution coming as a sales tax. Of a 0.25 on the ballot.
I'll second that motion.
And that, Clyde, let me, I'm sorry, that would basically be approving this motion, the sales tax. Yes. Okay.
And we have a motion and a second. And just let me read what Clyde presented to us as the way it would have to appear on the ballot. And that is simply, shall an order authorizing X amount, whatever X amount is, in this case, I guess it'd be $20 million for the financing. For financing the purchase of land and the construction of Alamance Community College facilities, then I guess we would add and economic development infrastructure funds or however you would do it be approved. And I just read the wrong one. I did. I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, I read the wrong one.
Clyde's not listening.
Clyde's not paying attention to me. Craig's not paying attention to me. So, right. Here it is. On the ballot, it would simply say, for or against, local sales and use tax at the rate of 0.25% in addition to all their state and local sales and use taxes. Clyde, is that right?
That's it. That's what the statute requires.
And then your job and our job and the folks that are interested in economic development is their job is to educate everybody on what this means. And I think we can do that.
Yeah.
Well, that's not the right attitude, Martin. All right, we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good. Thank you all again for being here.
Thank you.
That was the motion.
That was part of that. The bond referendum for $15 million. And $5 million for economic development.
We just voted to put.
The bond
we did not. Okay.
The bond referendum will
What's
not
that
go
we
the
need
sales
to be,
tax.
Then we need to vote again.
No, it will not be listed. If you vote separately for a bond referendum, what you're then you're basically negating what we just did.
Yeah.
Okay.
The sales tax referendum will be what will be on the referendum. What we will do at our next meeting is pass a resolution that will outline what the $3.8 million, your intention that money be spent on.
And that's when it can go to ACC.
Yeah.
Right, that's okay. What you say. That
but we've already said tonight that's what it's going to be. You're
right.
Just
going
right. to you're gonna bring us that.
The impetus for the sales tax is the debt service for ACC.
For the ACC bond and economic development.
Okay. All right, thank you. Any other items under item 6? Item 7, ACC Board of Trustee appointment. Each of us received in our package is information on 3 individuals. This time I'd like to just summarize what we've been given. The 3 applicants, one is Mr. Bill Gomery. Bill is the regional executive of BB&T here in Alamance County. He's been in Alamance County for 17 years. Has served on the ACC Foundation for how many years? You know, 7 years maybe? Served as president a couple times.
One time.
Himself went to a community college in Florida growing up. He is one of the applicants. The second applicant is Dr. Charles Scott. Dr. Scott is a physician here in Alamance County, has been here all of his life, and that's Bill's letter. He's employed with Burlington Mebane Pediatrics and has some support and some relatives that were certainly very involved with Alamance Community College. And the third individual we have, his name, but Tori, I don't believe there was a specific application attached, was there? All I have is, I just have one page. It's really just the applicant information. That's all we have, okay. And that's Clifford, is it Otis? Resident of Burlington, been here 5 years. There's really no other information, so I don't know anything else about this individual. Three names out there who have applied. I'll at this time open it up for discussion. Is there any discussion on any of these individuals?
Well, I have served on United Way with Bill, and he's been very active in that. And I mean, I know Bill has the interest of the community very much at heart, and I'm sure Dr. Scott does too. But having gone to community college, I think that is a little plus in his hat to understanding the parameters of that.
I've also served with Bill on his chamber when I was going to the chamber meetings. He was on that economic development for the chamber. Actually, he was president of the chamber.
Yeah,
he's been
right.
Very active.
President of the chamber as well.
I don't have a problem with Bill.
Are any of the nominees or
unless Mr. Otis is here, I don't see Dr. Scott or Mr. Gomery. And I'm sorry, I just don't know the third individual, so I would say no to him. Any other comments about the applicants? If not, entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion that we put Bill Gomery in for that.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Eddie. Linda, any discussion? Call for the question. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Congratulations, Bill. All right, item 8, 6 Mile. We're going from 5 to 6, right, Dave? Where's Dave?
He's over there.
5 to 6 Mile Fire District Presentation Resolution. Dave Leonard, Fire Marshal. Welcome, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I come before you tonight requesting this resolution be passed that we could move forward from our current 5 mile insurance rating districts to an expanded 6 mile district. If you will remember, several months back we started this process of making sure that all of our fire departments in our area were prepared to move forward to what is referred to as a 6 mile insurance rating district. Currently, all of the fire departments that you have listed on this resolution or at what the state refers to as a 5 mile insurance district. By pushing this forward to a 6 mile district, it would allow those residents and businesses within that area to have a lower insurance rating of a 9 versus a 10. If you will recall, several months back, we had the Deputy State Fire Marshal, Tim Bradley, come and speak to us in regards to how these ratings are put together, one being the best rating, and a rating of 10 being the lowest rating, or what the insurance service offices recognize as being no insurance rating and a 10. So by moving forward to the 6 mile rating, any resident that is within 6 miles of that fire station, and you have the maps before you, will be able to entertain at least between that 5 and 6 mile range an insurance rating of 9. We have been working very diligently with the fire departments, with the Office of the State Fire Marshal's Office, and with our local GIS here in the county to put forth all the packet that is needed, and this resolution is one of those items that is needed to be taken to the Office of the State Fire Marshal's Office for their review. So by passing that tonight, this will be the last item that I need to complete to give to the State Fire Marshal's Office. They will review all this information. Once we get this information together for them, they will review it all. When they give their approval, they will send it to the insurance service offices, and they will get their approval done on that too as well, to make sure that all of our maps, all of our information and documentation is there. Our local fire departments, their boards, their board presidents, their secretaries had to sign resolutions stating that they were going to provide a certain amount of service, which I have too in this packet that I will be submitting to the state fire marshal's office. I also have a letter from our fire chiefs association president, Drew Sharp, and I'd like to read this. It says, please accept this letter as confirmation that all fire chiefs in Alamance County support the recognition and acceptance of the ISO 6-mile insurance districts. These extended areas are already included in the individual fire response districts and have been covered by the various fire departments. By the Board of County Commissioners approving the insurance district extensions, there will be no additional impact or burdens placed upon the fire departments. The property owners living in these areas will benefit greatly by having their insurance premiums reduced. Thank you for your service to Alamance County. And again, that is signed by Drew Sharp, who is the president of the Alamance County Fire Chiefs Association. So again, I'd ask for your approval on this resolution. I'll entertain any questions that you may have regarding this.
Dave, I have one question, and you may have covered this when we initially talked about this, but when this is all done, you're going to have some that are like button up against each other, right?
Yes, sir.
So what happens to existing boundaries that are already under six? They just stay the same?
Yes, sir. They stay the same. You have certain types of districts, and one being the response district. Those response districts will stay the same. Then you have a tax district in which they draw from the county, from the citizens and businesses with that area for their tax rating. And then you have the insurance rating districts too as well. So that will stay the same.
Well, then the other side of that is once this goes from five to six, how much white are you going to have left in the county?
If you look at each individual map, you will see like a little red line in some of the fire departments that will still have areas outside of their 6-mile range once we expand to that. Are AO, E.M. Holt, Snow Camp, Mebane, Eli Whitney, and Northeast Fire Departments. You'll see a little red line indicated as our GIS has put that on there for us. Any area beyond that little red line will be outside of their 6-mile district. And that is road miles. It's very crucial that you know that. We could have a subdivision to be built right now, and by road miles, if it was more than 6 miles from that fire station's bay door, then it would be outside of its 6-mile district. So just because it's all inclusive in that one area, it is road miles, and that's what you have to look at. For instance, some of E.M. Holt's territory, you actually have to go outside of Alamance County into Guilford County to get back into the northern part of that area, which is outside their 6-mile district. I will also tell you that a lot of our fire departments are preparing to provide coverage for that area. AO is entertaining adding a second station up on the north side to eliminate their 6-mile district, or all their territory will be then inclusive to eliminate that area that's outside. Mebane Fire Department has been for years putting forth a study to put their second station somewhere in the southern part of their territory too as well. Therefore, they will be able to have full coverage within their 6-mile district. So again, these are fire departments that are out there looking at this. E.M. Holt is entertaining the same idea of putting a station up on that side too as well.
But the rating that you mentioned going from 10 down to what the municipalities are 4 and 5, is that right?
Yes, sir. I also have that listing too as well. Most of our rural departments are anywhere from a 5 to an 8 in that area. Some of our, like for instance, AO Fire Department is a 6. Eli Whitney is a 6. Elon has a split district. They have inside the city limits, which is a 4, and then the rural area is a 5. Fawcett is a 7. Hall River is a 4. E.M. Holt is a 7. And Mebane has a split district, 3 inside the city limits and 5 outside. North Central is a 7. Northeast is a 7. Snow Camp's a 7. Swepsonville has a split, 5 and 6. Graham is a 4, and Burlington and Gibsonville, Burlington being a 3 and Gibsonville a 5.
Does the taxing authority go from 5 miles to 6 miles?
The insurance premium is ranked.
That's
basically
how they rate the premium.
If you're within
that.
A 5-mile district, yeah. you will be able to have this type of insurance rating apply to your premiums.
And that'll go to 6.
I'm concerned about, does it include that 6 miles? Everybody that lives within that 6 miles is going to be part of the taxing system to it, that fire department, is that right?
That's the tax district. That's something totally different.
Okay.
This is insurance rating.
That's what I'm saying.
Yes, sir.
They may have already been in the tax district.
They're already in their tax districts, and that is set up. Their tax districts are set up.
So they're going to have to cover more than what their tax area is.
No, sir. It's already their response district.
Uh-huh.
That's their response district.
Okay.
All of their districts are set forth to boundaries drawn up between all the fire departments as to who's responding to where.
Okay. On this one here, see that red line, even though you got green on this side, they're taxed by EM Hope Fire District.
Isn't the homeowner going to benefit from the fire department's lower?
Most greatly, yes, sir.
Okay, so where I thought Bill was going, the folks outside of the 6 miles when this is done, so their rating won't
they will
affect.
Still be 18.
So there's, yeah, okay,
yes,
so
sir.
If you're not within 6 miles, they're all 10.
Currently, if you are outside the 5 mile, your insurance company can charge you their highest premium rate set based on a 10 insurance rate.
And the difference is we're going from 5 to 6.
You're going from 6 miles, which will put you at a 9.
Brings more people in,
yes, sir,
to that.
Insurance agency has set it forth as stating that anything between that 5 and 6 will be considered a 9.
So if you're beyond 6, you're still going to be a 10.
Yes, sir. Yeah. That is correct.
I had a neighbor who said his insurance went up 42%. Well, they're charging him 42% more because he's outside even the 6 mile. He lives kind of next to Lake McIntosh, and there's area there where the city doesn't cover, and I don't know how would that work once the city built a station on the low end
annexes
there.
That area, then they would Burlington is a 3, and it would be within their 6 mile once they put that station there. Actually, it would be within their 5, I would probably venture to say.
But it's still based on the taxing authority of that area, though, isn't it?
Based on the insurance rating. It's not the taxing of that area. It's the insurance rating.
Okay, so if Burlington built a station and it's 3 miles from him, even though it's in the city, and he's not in the city,
if he was in Burlington city limits, he would be part of their response district. Therefore, he would entertain.
It doesn't matter how close that station might end up next to.
That would be their response district, yes, sir, that is drawn up.
I wasn't sure how that worked. Okay.
With the different types of maps and things that are out there, I could understand, you know, it's very hard to keep up with a lot of those different types. Like I said, insurance, response, and tax districts are the three that we deal with.
Well, I don't know why we wouldn't vote for this.
Well,
I agree.
Yeah, you've got a lot of homework on this. Part of the education, I think, it's been very helpful to me in just explaining. And I'm glad you've come here a couple of different times so we can retain it a little bit at a time.
Yes, sir.
I'll make the motion we accept this.
Thank you, Bill. The second by Eddie. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, sir. And Linda said this letter really needs to go to you. I have no idea.
I'm not sure if it's his or yours. Yes, ma'am. But it's not mine. I got
okay.
it. It's not mine.
This time we'll call on Dr. Barry Bass, Health Director, to give us a pertussis outbreak update. Barry, good evening, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Actually, I'm just Mr. Barry Bass. So I aspire to be a doctor, perhaps, but work in progress. Thank you. I'm here this evening to talk to you about pertussis and what's been going on in Alamance County. And
is that considered whooping cough?
That is exactly the first sentence.
That's the word.
Yes, sir. It is indeed whooping cough.
Yeah.
And it's a respiratory disease, and it consists of a series of violent coughs, which makes it hard to breathe. And also it can be fatal in infants, and that's a big concern that we have because of the impact it has on small children. The epidemics in the United States occur every 3 to 5 years. And it's usually underdiagnosed and underreported. So there are currently 17,000 cases that have occurred in the United States in the past year. There are 27,550 in 2010. There have been 10 deaths to infants less than three months old this year. Currently in the United States, there are outbreaks going on in Washington State where there are 2,883 cases, and they've declared an epidemic in Washington State. There are 2,815 cases in Wisconsin and 1,241 cases in the state of Minnesota. And there are currently 37 states that have ongoing pertussis cases. The concern that was raised, and this came about during the course of a virus situation here in Alamance County, that we had conversations with CDC about the fact of what was going on, because we were seeing a lot of children who were properly immunized who are getting sick, which has raised the question, is there an issue with the efficacy of the vaccine that we're giving children, or is it the fact that the schedule of which they're receiving their immunizations, is that the problem? So now CDC is examining those criteria and saying, well, exactly what is the problem? Is it the vaccine itself that we've been given, or is it the issue that the schedule of when the children receive their vaccine? So about the time we peaked, and the data that you all have, about the time ours peaked, there were cases reported in Guilford County, and then subsequently there have been cases in Catawba County. Catawba County's happened like the last week of school, and that, you know, when you're trying to do epidemiological tracing, the kids are out of school, then you're trying to run everybody down. Exactly. It's kind of like, you know, so anyway, and then we also had a 3-month-old child in Pitt County within the last couple of weeks that had been diagnosed. That child had onset of symptoms while he's traveling abroad. So the good news for us is that the cases in Alamance County are continuing to decline. As you can see from the information included in your packet, and I know the first set of information I sent you all was probably a bit busy. Some of my staff got together and gave you those nice curves, which really shows it very graphically, about where we had peaked back in December, February. And then, you know, the fact that we had total now 148 cases. And on the bar graph, as you can see, the median age of the people with the disease is 9 years old. And again, what we found is 83% of the folks who have been diagnosed are presumed diagnosed that they were properly immunized. So to date, what we've done is we've immunized nearly 3,000 people in Alamance County, 2,962. We conducted a mass clinic in Mebane in March 2nd of 2012. We have given additional immunizations at the at the Alamance Regional Medical Center, a baby fair. We've given additional shots at March for Babies, working with the school system and also child care centers. And we obviously continue to give vaccine at the health department. So the result of, again, of our ongoing cases here, the state now, we're offering it statewide, the TDAP is free at no cost. We will fast track folks who come to the health department between 9 and 11 and from 1 to 4 p.m. With no check-in required. We have a special system set up to get folks through. But I think the important message that we have now in Alamance County is to remind folks that the most important thing to do is get vaccinated. To, you know, tell our folks the best thing they can do is, you know, get vaccine, especially for adults, because we are kind of a barrier to the children. And so again, that vaccine is free. We continue to see one or two cases a week, so it hasn't gone away. It's still out there. And you know, one of the things too, to educate parents about, you know, the kids that have the ongoing cough, because we don't want to see kids who are maybe infectious who are showing up at summer camps. And as you all may know, that next week the school system will start up its year-round school system, you know, schools, so for people to be vigilant and aware. One of the things too have been excited about is tentatively the Secretary of the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, Al Delia, and our State Health Director, Dr. Laura Gerald, is planning to come to Alamance County on July the 30th to kick off the North Carolina statewide our National Immunization Awareness Month in August. So they recognize the good work, that even though we've had to really battle in terms of the outbreak, that they've recognized the good work that we've done. So tentatively that's set, and we're excited about them coming and visit us and recognizing the good work that our staff has done.
Wasn't she the lady that you took her job?
No, sir. That would not be me.
She wouldn't be coming here, would
she? Well, no, she left on her own. Oh. We hired
Barry. Yeah.
To replace her.
Oh, that was Dorothy. Dorothy Salenti. Okay. Dorothy will probably be here. She's at UNC Institute for Public Health.
Okay.
But yes, sir. But Dr. Gerald's was with the Health and Wellness Institute.
Okay.
Health and Wellness.
Barry.
Yes, ma'am.
If you I'm pretty sure I had the whooping cough as a child because I can basically remember, you know, not a baby, but, you know, 5 or 6 or 7 years old. Does that give you immunity or should I come and get a shot?
I would recommend you get a shot. We'll be happy to shoot you.
I know y'all are. I've just had several shots.
Any of the board members, anybody in the fellowship, we'd be happy to give you an immunization. Just let us know and we'll make special
arrangements. I had one in both arms at one point over there, so.
But again, you know, the idea and the concept is like for the adults, for us to provide protection for the, you know, for the children too. Well, if you had your tetanus shot, that, you know, you're getting a pertussis now, the Tdap. That's part of it.
So I had a tetanus, but it's been 10 years
now. And is that one of the required ones that the students enter
our
school system, they have to show evidence?
Exactly, yes, sir. And the last one you get for like is before you enter kindergarten. And they don't get the next one until like 6th grade. And that's part of what they're studying now is the fact that you're seeing younger kids, like you see here, our median age is, you know, like 9-year-olds, but those are like 4th graders, 5th graders. So now they're thinking about moving the requirement from the 6th grade requirement to 5th grade. So yes, sir, you usually receive a series of 4, and then when you go off to college, you need it again. And then again, as adults, we need to also be immunized.
When I had a tetanus shot when I went to Thailand.
It may have just been straight tetanus.
So it probably
check
was.
And see if they have the
so what's the frequency in adults that you recommend now?
Well, that's every 10 years goes along with the tetanus. So.
But now it's the teen, sir, whatever your
Tdap.
The Tdap, yes, sir.
But that's recommended for adults, too?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Well,
even in grown-ups, we have to get our vaccinations also.
I don't know that I've had one, so I guess we'll all
be
able to see you.
We'll be happy
soon.
To set you up. Absolutely, yes, sir.
Well, let me get politically incorrect here. I'm known for that, to agree. I, for one, believe that we have compromised our health standards in America with a lot of the social issues that are out there and tolerances for things that we just might have to tolerate. First of all, I'd like to ask why I had to read about the statewide news release in the Greensboro News and Record before I saw it from your office to our office. I mean, I'm sitting there in my house reading. I read 3 papers every morning. And there was a news brief in the Greensboro News and Record said that the State Health Department had said that Alamance Counties, in a 6-month review of 23 counties that were reporting, that Alamance County had I think it was almost 60-some percent, almost 70% of the total cases reported. Almost 70%. 68%, I think it was exact percentage, if I'm not mistaken. Somebody told me, I didn't do it myself. That we had the number of cases we had of whooping cough, pertussis, whatever, was the highest in the state by far, and that we had the same number, we had more cases than the whole state had the prior year. Now, what bothers me is why I had to read about that in the Greensboro News and Record rather than a bulletin coming from your office through Craig's office through to us. Can you explain that?
Well, certainly, yes, sir. The news release was sent by the Division of Public Health. It was sent statewide. The first phone call that we got preceding that news release was from Winston-Salem Journal. The news release, I think, came out on a Tuesday. Wednesday, Richard Craver, who's with the Winston-Salem Journal, reported it. That day, then the next day, the Thursday that you read the article, it came out in the Greensboro News and Record. Friday, our PIO officer had a conversation with a reporter from the Times News, and it came out in the Times News on a Sunday. So the issue is, I think.
But I hadn't called the Times News to tell them about the news release. That's what I don't understand is why.
Well, they should have. Could I defer to Mr. Lavender? Don't you all usually get statewide news releases that come? The statewide news releases go out to all the newspapers and all the media in the state. So they would have received it. Is that, you guys don't get it.
I have no idea. It should come to us. It might not come to me personally. And if you come to our office, then maybe you have a problem.
We can certainly follow up with the, get an issue about being on the mailing list. But the point is, it was released, statewide, and we have no control over how the media chooses to, who chooses to respond back to that. But I think the other part is, in Alamance County, we have been aware, you may remember back in February, I met with the school board and did a presentation on with Dr. Shapley Quinn, discussing it, because at that time was when it was peaking. So I think it's a matter of that most of our community, I would have, again, this may have been a mistake on my part, but have assumed that we've had an ongoing issue here, with the outbreak. And that in terms of our staff trying to work and, work with the different providers, working with the physicians and working with the hospitals, that we've been trying to stay on top of it. So just in terms of the media and how they choose to present it, that would be.
Didn't your health department get the news release from Raleigh?
We did get the news release, yes, sir, but we didn't respond to it.
I would assume you'd get it just as quick as the newspaper would.
We, in fact, did. So,
no offense, I would have thought we would have gotten it, too, pretty quick. To me, I'm a numbers person and I'm a law of averages person. Why Alamance County? I mean, kids sit beside kids in schools all across this state. Kids play with kids at the daycares all across this state. They play with each other in their neighborhoods all across this state. Why is Alamance County standing out like a sore thumb on pertussis?
Well, we may be doing a good job of
identifying it.
We may have done a really good job of finding out who's there. We may have done a good job of working with our physicians so we know to look for it. So that may be part of it. Or we just... And, just I understand your law of numbers. Sometimes you just get lucky or unlucky.
Unlucky in this case, maybe.
But in terms of us, we certainly, as our agency, has been very. I think I'm proud of the work that our staff has done in terms of trying to go how they've approached the our response to the disease outbreak. And again, we've had more cases, and I think that happens in the community. I could certainly drill down and ask questions to the other, other powers that be and see if there are similar communities, and I'd be happy to do that for you.
Well, I've asked questions. I had a state person call me back. I've been given information at the state level that I'm told at the local level I can't get. And if there's a block it's checked, I think we all have a right to ask the question as to what that block is and what the answer is. For a total, and I've asked questions in the past about are there any patterns showing up? Are there any trends showing up? And I can't seem to get some answers that I think ought to be. It's like asking somebody, why do you think? Just to give you an example, why do you think? What's German measles?
That's rubella.
Yeah, rubella. Why rubella broke out like crazy in Chatham County? And you can ask somebody, they'll give you a politically correct answer, but they won't give you the truth. They won't give you the real answer. And I think we know what that is without getting into that.
Let's go ahead. Let's stop
eating your own question. You just keep taking pictures there. you do the reporting later.
So,
do you not see a trend in this at all, as far as socioeconomic or backgrounds or cultures?
Those who don't understand what you're talking about. They're talking about illegal immigration.
Yeah.
People coming here with those diseases, passing it on to everybody else.
And lack of vaccinations.
It's not politically correct to say, but it's the damn truth.
The stats that I was given, let me ask you another question. Why is there so many, a category of unknown and other, when you ask for the, cultural or ethnicity or the background of that person? Why is there such a high percentage of those answers under categories of other and unknown?
Well, like initially, when we were first doing the case findings, we weren't taking the time to check all the blocks in that regard in terms of socioeconomic data, because we're more important to find out where the people lived
and their ages, and if they were in schools or whatever. So I think initially that we found out that 55%, I think it was first reported, that 55% of our cases were unknown. That's down to 27%. And I would say that the number has gone down because we are doing a better job now of reporting all those different identifiers. And so that to answer your question, I think that would be what has transpired. That, you know, in terms of the unknowns, is that we are now checking the blocks, whereas initially we weren't doing that as diligently as happening now.
I know we didn't ask for this, but I've talked to you in the past about, what about tuberculosis? The what kind of stats are you seeing on test positive cases or people that have been tested or whatever the levels are of what you do with TB?
There seems to be no ethnic in terms of who's getting sick with it.
I mean, what are we seeing? An increase is what I'm asking.
In tuberculosis. Mm-hmm. I would need to go check. I don't think we are. I think it's been stable. But I'd be happy to go back and look that up for you.
But it's an increase from the past, would you say, as far as test positive cases or ever what people receiving medication?
I think the TB is staying fairly stable. What we're seeing is an increase in sexually transmitted diseases. Mm-hmm. I mean, in terms of if you're looking epidemiologically, what's out in our community and communicable disease, that's tending to be where most of our increases in terms of communicable disease is sexually transmitted diseases as opposed to these other diseases.
Well, it's like I've said before, and I'll say it again, and I hope I'll be quiet on this, but told you when you first came on, please don't dance around issues with us. If you see something that a legislator needs to know about that would help curtail issues in America at our local level and let it go all the way up to state and federal level, we need to know about it. I mean,
absolutely.
If you know why, if you basically know why there's an increase in a certain disease, short of just politically correct answers, and I think that's what we get a lot of. I mean, it's like when you, again, talk to somebody and say, do you know why, what is it, German measles again?
Rubella.
I keep getting that word. Okay. Pertussis.
Rubiola and rubella.
Why do you think that really was such a deal in Siler City, Chatham County? You know, and you can't get a straight answer from nobody on that.
Well, but the other part too is like, you know, what I'm saying is that, like, what we're seeing is that the children who are getting this are properly immunized, regardless of ethnicity. They're all, you know, they're in schools and they're properly immunized. So we're, you know, seeing. And it transcends ethnicity. Just kids are getting sick. But I would say that there's no disproportional incidence of disease in any particular ethnic group. That based on population and number of children, that it's within what would be what I would say is a normal number, given the number of population.
Well, I would like to believe that it's because you jumped on top of it, but. My gut feeling is we got more cases disproportionate to other areas because of other reasons other than what you're telling us. And I can't prove it.
Well, I'll be happy to. I think you've already got the numbers from
Dr. Moore. I see them. But to be number one in the state is alarming, and to have more cases than the whole state had last year, I think speaks for itself. And I just have to roll with that type of.
Well, and again, I'm very willing to have conversations with the state EPI and with CDC and see, you know, other communities our size, is there, you know, what might be a particular reason. I'll be happy to follow up on that for you, sir.
Well, I asked a question why 23 counties, well, they said that's the only counties that's showing an alarm.
I mean, yeah, there's, from what we can tell, the pattern, it just happens in certain places, but I don't have a good answer for that because I don't, epidemiologically, I don't know myself.
Very good. Thank you.
Other questions for Barry? Thank you, sir.
Sorry,
thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah,
appreciate
your
time.
Yeah.
Next item on the agenda, we asked Gerald York to come join us and give us an update on a particular series of bills that were introduced and floated through the North Carolina legislature this year. And I believe the compromise bill, was that 462, ended up being the compromise? That was a Senate bill, wasn't it?
Yes,
Bill?
Senate bill.
The Senate bill. take us through the original introduction of the bill from the House, if you would. This has to do with contingency fees for audits, primarily to business property, I believe.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for being here with us.
Yes, sir. On June the 7th, the Senate Commerce Committee attempted to pass an amendment to House Bill 462 that would ban contingency fee auditing in North Carolina as of July 1st, 2012.
Can you back up and kind of define what contingency fee auditing is?
Contingency fee we now have with Tax Management Associates. I invited those folks in. We pay them 25% of any monies that we collect on the discoveries. They audit our businesses in the county. We've got about 4,500 businesses in the county. They would average auditing about 100 businesses per year. And any discovered value that they find, we would tax them on it. And if, say, we receive $500, we would pay them $125 of that fee. About 50% of the time, there is no discovery made. We do not pay the company when they don't make a discovery, so there's no expense to the taxpayer. This is strictly paid for by the business that violates and does not report the taxable income. I think that is the fairest way to do it. The other avenue would be a fee which the taxpayers would have to pay for all audits. The contingency fee audit seems to be the most logical. I'm not sure why this was proposed, other than big business had this proposed and passed. They did delay the implementation until July 1st, 2013. So as of that date, the county is going to have to go to another type of auditing, which be fee-based or whatever the county decides on. I've invited Kirk Boone from Tax Management Associates to talk tonight, and he can talk about the different types of auditing fees. I was very upset myself over them stopping the contingency fee auditing. It didn't cost the taxpayers a penny. The people who paid for that were the people who had underreported or not reported their taxable properties. So there was no cost to the average taxpayer. I personally don't understand why that was passed, and I objected to that, but I don't have the final say-so over that. I think this is going to be another burden put on the taxpayers of the county that shouldn't be put on.
And as far as how it flowed, there originally was a House bill that was proposed, there was a comparable Senate bill, and then there was a compromise bill. Is that
yes,
correct?
Yes, sir. The North Carolina Association of County Commissioners entered into a compromise with the legislators by changing the effective date until July 1st, 2013.
So it's still going to
same
happen?
Yes,
there's been a delay of...
Yes, sir. It's delayed to July 1st, 2013. There'll be a two-year study window. I don't think we'll ever have contingency fee audits again. That's my opinion.
So we have them for another 12 months?
Yes, sir. We have 12 months to decide how we will conduct the audits if the county wants to continue auditing, and I assume we would, but that would have to be a fee-based or hiring a CPA on staff or whatever the county wanted to do. Again, Kirk Boone from Tax Management is here. He can discuss options with us. They have performed our audit for a number of years. They do an excellent job. They educate the businesses, which is part of the auditing, is going to these businesses and educating them, letting them know what they have to report. It's not a punitive thing. Apparently a lot of folks think it is, but it's not as much an educational tool as it is to discover unreported taxable properties.
And most other counties do the same thing?
Yes, sir. The majority of the county use contingency fee. Apparently some counties don't audit at all. I think some of the smaller counties do not audit. And some counties have a staff auditor as well as contingency fee auditing. I believe Durham County has three different sources of auditing their business.
So the larger counties would have somebody on staff?
Yes, sir.
And, is that an option, I guess, that we're going to have to look
yes,
at?
Yes, sir.
Some way.
It would be an option.
Yeah.
But we're very satisfied with Tax Management Associates. County has done business with them for a number of years. We have never had a complaint, to my knowledge. They have skilled people on staff, several CPAs. They're the largest auditing firm in the state. And we have no issues with them. but I would like for Mr. Boone to discuss the options with
sure.
you. Sure. Any more questions?
So, well, let me ask. So what you're saying then is, in the new way, the business isn't really paying to not for that?
No, sir. The county would have to have some type of appropriation where we would pay a fee whether there was a discovery made or not. The way it works now, if we discover unreported taxable property, then that company pays the taxes, and we pay the auditing firm 25% of after we collect it. So the taxpayers are not out any money. Only
to just
spending
do that, right.
taxpayers
it's only
out
once
money.
It's found.
Right. Okay. If we go the other way, we will have to pay
up somebody
front
to
and
do it,
right.
And
right.
no matter what comes out of it.
Right, right. Unless Mr. Boone has a better option for us.
Well, that's good. Maybe he can share that with us.
Well, I would say the highly touted Mr. Boone needs to come up front and talk to us.
He evidently has some answers.
Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to come be with you all this evening in Alamance County. A little bit of history is that 25 years ago, Cleveland County, North Carolina, Shelby, asked TMA to come up with some type of a compliance program for the business auditing. Counties look at real property every so many years, and they go out and verify if any new constructions occurred, and they measure it, and all of that. They make sure that exemptions that they're giving out are being given by qualified folks, so everybody's on a level playing field. And so 25 years ago, the assessor in Cleveland County said, "Can you help us out with this business personal property tax?" And we actually gave them a fee proposal at that time. That, yeah, we can do that. We had recently hired someone from Mecklenburg County that had been doing it for a number of years there. And so we gave them a fee proposal to review all of the business listings. And the tax assessor said, "Well, that's half of my budget. I can't do that. How about you guys putting a little skin in the game, and you go out and do the work, and if you find anything, then we will pay you on a percentage of how much is actually found." Now, a little bit of the misinformation that has come from 25 years ago is that this is some kind of a recent thing, and it's very invasive to businesses. Also, that the auditor himself somehow has an incentive to create numbers or to find things that aren't really there, because that's how the auditor makes their money, and that all of those things are simply not true. As I said, 25 years ago is when this started, and we realized at the time that if we weren't aligned with the wishes and the desires of the Board of County Commissioners, the tax office, and even the business community, then we wouldn't be working there long. So it's a very fair process. When you hear audit, it immediately triggers the IRS thing. So we like to say, that's not what the process is like at all. It's more similar to what Mr. York has described. Also, our auditors are paid on a flat salary. There is no bonus or salary or any kind of incentive for our auditors to find anything or create numbers, which can't be done anyway. It's really a black and white type process. Either the numbers are there on the financial records of the company or they're not there, and does it match what's actually being reported? And another big point that Mr. York shared was that actually the number is a little higher statewide. It's almost like 60-70% of businesses are doing the right thing, and they really deserve to know that everybody's doing the right thing. And without such a program, it's only going to incentivize everybody to maybe fudge a little bit. And what we really find, though, is most folks are very honest. There's not really a big problem on up into the 90% range. A great majority of folks are just not familiar with what they need to be doing, and they're actually, after the process is over, they say that was pretty painless, and would like to, I hope you come back and do it again in a few years if it has to be done. So like most counties that do this process, you probably don't want to have any new taxes. And in order to not have any new taxes, you need to administer the ones that are required by law as effectively as possible. Because if that doesn't happen, then you got to say, well, where's our revenue going? And we're not measuring and listing correctly. We're not making sure the businesses are listed correctly. So we've got to come up with some new money somewhere. Then you have to increase tax rates or come up with a new tax, and nobody really wants to do that. And just to complete the picture, we're still working in Cleveland County 25 years later, and still using contingency fee operation. And I have not heard anything in the news lately about a lot of problems with what over half of the counties are doing. So this really came out of nowhere, surprised the County Commissioners Association, certainly surprised us, and all of the local governments across North Carolina.
Where was this bill? What representative instituted this on the agenda?
I don't claim to know the whole story still, but it was House Bill 462, as the name says, was a House bill, and when it came over to the Senate, it was it had nothing to do with what this finally ended up as. So there were 43 full-time lobbyists pushing this legislation. So that tells you that there was a lot of money behind it. And so this House bill was stripped of its original language in the Senate, replaced by this language that would have become effective July 1, 2012. At that time, on the floor in Senate committee, when nobody else got to speak, they said, if counties want to continue this type of arrangement, they need to go out and renew their contracts as soon as possible, because it doesn't affect any contracts that are in existence as of July 1, 2012. So we did that, and many counties all over North Carolina renewed their contracts, got three-year extensions so we could keep doing business. And then the amendment that they changed, which was in Senate Bill 847, Senate Bill 847 said if House Bill 462 passes, then the prohibition against contingency fee auditing won't start until July 1, 2013. So that's what actually gives us another year to think about how we want to continue things moving forward. We have some good ideas that will help Alamance County with your budget issues. We think we can arrange a fee-based system that has what we call a delayed invoicing, so you don't actually have to pay for the work until after things start happening as a result of the program. So we see it as in effect. If you want to continue working with TMA, we see it having very little effect in Alamance County. And we'll be working with your tax office to share those options. And we're not going anywhere. So we want to help, continue to help if we can.
Very good.
Well, thank you, Mr. Boone. We did get a lot of information from Gerald. Gerald mentioned June 7th. I mean, it all happened fairly quickly. It was coming about, less than 3 weeks before the session was going to adjourn.
I think it's part of a national initiative, and I think part of the reasoning behind it came from some practices that were done in other states where the process was not as open and fair and equitable. I mean, as you know, there's many levels of appeal, and business personal property, your business personal property program probably has some of the least issues of any property tax issues.
Appeals and stuff, yeah.
Not say it's not without problems. Any tax is going to have folks that don't like the tax. I mean, I don't like the tax, but
to be treated fairly like everybody else.
And it needs to be done fairly and equitably. Yeah.
Well, and on that subject, Mr. Bell also was very interested as part of his position with the chairman of the Board of Equalization Review about what you just said. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate you all educating us more, and please keep us posted over the next 12 months on what you guys are looking at. Because I assume something else could be presented to the legislature next year.
We want to do what's fair. We're for the taxpayers. We're citizens of this county, as you know, have always lived here, and I want to do what's best for the citizens of Alamance County, and I'm sure I'll look
good. Yeah.
Thank you, Gerald.
Thank you
very
appreciate
much.
Appreciate it very much.
Okay, the next item is the consent agenda item, Bill, that you wanted to pull relating to the local emergency declaration ordinance. There is an ordinance in our package that's been submitted to us for review. What was yours?
The problem I have with this, I think it's unconstitutional. When you're going to control businesses, you're going to stop selling gas, and you're going to stop legal people to assemble. It is unconstitutional. I'm not going to support this. I think it's It's what it's going to do is turn Alamance County into a police state, and I won't be part of it.
Where did it come from?
I drafted it about 3 years ago at Mr. Smith's direction when we had our gas shortage. Remember when gas spiked and was heading to $5 a gallon? And it was never passed for whatever reason. And with the recent storm that took out West Virginia and Virginia and Maryland, we thought maybe it would be a good time to do this again, because in those states there was no electricity, no cell phone coverage, no water, no fuel, and it was a complete state of disarray.
Isn't there a challenge up in Maiden, North Carolina? The same thing right here.
I'm aware of a challenge.
Where is Maiden? Is that in the mountains?
Maiden is.
Maiden's.
Yeah, it's between Lincoln and Catawba County.
Okay, I don't know where it was taken, but I read there was several years ago, there's a case out there where basically it was saying they could take guns away from people and so forth and so on. It's Big Brother at its best. I agree with Bill totally on it. And you got to read between the lines on some of this stuff, in my opinion. There is a challenge out there, and before I did vote for that, I want to know what the challenge is somewhere in the state of North Carolina right now where some city is trying to do the same thing and people are fighting it like crazy. And I don't know. I want to say Maiden. For some reason, that's on my mind. But I can't swear to it. But King, it is King, North Carolina? So it's in the mountains.
Well,
okay. It's down.
Are you familiar with what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Okay.
Is it involving a weather-related disaster?
I'm not sure what auspices they used to bring it up, but it was about guns. Is what the thing was about.
It's for everything. Okay. I mean, they've got everything in all
control.
Ways. It's what they can claim. They need to go against what you normally would be able to do, claiming an emergency, this or that or the other. It was more encompassing than just guns, though, if I'm not mistaken. And there's a big challenge up wherever that is. Did they ever settle it?
I don't know if they have.
Okay, but it's King, North Carolina?
I'm pretty sure it's King.
All right.
That's down highway, what, 52?
52.
52.
Would y'all be comfortable just tabling this and sending it back to Clyde and let him do some research and see if it's worth revisiting?
Yeah, I'm going to make the motion that we table it.
Second.
For a second.
Second.
Any other discussion?
I knew it was in the mountains, but I wasn't sure where.
Okay. It's really in the foothills.
Yeah.
All up there. All right, we have a motion and a second to table this matter for future study back to our county attorney. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Good. Thank you. Speaking of our county attorney, do you have a bid report for us on the Graham Manor?
We advertised the bid in the newspaper 2 consecutive weeks. I sent the copy of the bid out to Piedmont NAI, which is a large commercial real estate, along also with some local real estate folks, Bob Lewis being one of them, and there's one other, Mr. Bob.
Richard Jones.
Richard Jones. And today was the deadline for accepting sealed bids, and we didn't receive any sealed bids.
Don't know about one.
Did you receive any non-sealed bids?
We didn't receive any bids.
That's bad.
We did receive a thank you from NAI Piedmont for telling about the property, but apparently they just don't have any interest at this time. I would suggest maybe we put it on our website along with our other foreclosure sale properties. Take some pictures of it, maybe put a sign out in front of the building that it's for sale, and see if we can generate any interest at all. If we do have any interest, we can come back and talk about another sealed bid at that point in time.
Any questions for Mr. Albright?
Nope.
Unfortunately. Thanks, Glenn. Flip your agenda, please. County Manager's Report. Craig, what do you have for us tonight?
First, I would like to hand to our county clerk a statement of our debt that is required for our refinancing. Basically, our net debt is $82 million. So it has to be in the record that it was handed to our clerk.
Is this the resolution that I'm supposed to read here?
No, sir. This is just a statement of our overall debt for the county. that we had to do before we entered into a resolution for the refinancing. And in front of you, you do have two resolutions. One is a resolution authorizing $40 million worth of refunding for bonds. And then the next resolution is order authorizing $40 million to be reissued. Again, we're doing refunding of our bonds. We've looked at it, and we think we can save about $1.4 million over the next 10 years. We will get final figures once they've been issued, but we will come out definitely to the positive.
Is that projection was that in with your budget?
Part of the savings, yes, sir.
Part of it?
Yes, sir.
First one year.
Yes, sir.
So it wouldn't be?
Not new money.
New money.
It's not new money. We've already counted.
All right.
Do we need to vote separately on the
yes,
break
sir.
It down?
One is motion to authorize refunding, and that would be one, and then the issuance of the $40 million would be the second.
All right, and what you recommend is highlighted in orange. I don't need to read.
I can't, I don't have reading glasses. You can read that, yes.
Well, I mean, I'm happy not to.
I think we're okay not to.
It says what Craig just said. Yeah. Basically, we're refinancing $40 million worth of debt. And the question is, do we need to do them in separate resolutions? Let's do. Is there a motion to retire the existing obligation of $40 million?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Now the motion is to obtain new financing in the amount of $40 million. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Bill ready. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
And I do want to mention, want to welcome Brian Haygood as his first meeting as Assistant County Manager, taking the place of Tim Burgess. Again, he will still be assuming his role as Recreation Director as well, but I appreciate having Brian on board, and we're excited to have him.
Welcome, Brian.
Yep.
Good. We'll get you some more work today. Hang on.
Brian's sure of that, aren't you?
So,
we're glad you're here, Brian.
Schools, just an update on the schools and school funding. You know, again, we had a lot of discussion about the budget that teachers will be getting a 1.2% pay increase this year. So I just wanted to make sure everybody was aware of that as well.
And that's from the state?
Yes, sir.
On our letter that we had in our weekly update, your plans are to contact Dr. Cox and their finance officer and start a dialogue with you and Amy.
If the board is okay with this, I feel like we need to have the dialogue with staff first and then bring the board in, if that's okay. Hopefully we can set some frameworks and come up with a recommendation that we can present the budget.
That has to do with the development of a fund balance policy.
Of fund balance policy and also talk about how we can have better communication. We haven't had it, and I'll take part of that responsibility as well. But we need to have much better and open communication.
Thank you, Craig. Anything else in your report?
No, sir.
I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143-318, 11A3, in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners, and receive a report regarding the case of Triumph LLC versus Alamance County, Caswell County, and the Alamance County LME. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And we'll go right next door. And Craig, Clyde, how long are we thinking?
10 minutes.